Thanks everyone for joining us today. My name is Jenny Hornick and I'm the Digital Marketing Coordinator here at JMIR Publications. And I'm very excited to welcome you to today's webinar, which is part of our JMIR Mental Health series in collaboration with the Society of Digital Psychiatry. So today's timely topic is Navigating the Digital Age, a Mental Health Perspective for Young People, where our speakers will reflect on MQ's latest report on the mental health impact of internet use on young people. So I'll pass things on to Dr. John Torous shortly to introduce today's guests. So Dr. Torous is the director of the Digital Psychiatry Division at Beth Israel Deaconess Medical Center, an affiliated teaching hospital of Harvard Medical School. He's also the editor-in-chief of JMIR Mental Health. So I will pass things off to you, John.
Excellent. Thank you, Jenny, and to JMIR and SODP. We have so much to cover today, and we have two wonderful guests, one here right now that I'm going to introduce them. And we're going to talk about this fantastic report that I put in the chat for all of you to see. So we're joined by Mariana Bolivar. She's been working for 14 years in program design, management, and monitoring evaluation of programs in global health and development. At MQ, she leads research in a wide range of digital mental health projects, looking across all different types of technology. Before joining MQ, she worked at the BMJ as a project manager of a $13 million global health program using digital learning technologies to improve clinical skills in infectious disease. In Colombia, she's worked with the United Nations program. And we're also joined by Tawanada Murepa. So Tawanda is the founder and executive secretary of Young People Mental Health Trust and co-founder of the W Evolve Consultancy. He co-directs the drug and substance use prevention among primary students in Zimbabwe. And he's co-created, I'm going to pronounce it wrong, so forgive me, Tawanda, but the YoPella WhatsApp platform that supported over 60,000 people since 2019. That's a lot of people. And I think that's a wonderful segue into the internet can allow us to reach a lot of people and do so much. So I want to talk about this report you all did, but the first question is, help us understand what is MQ for those who don't understand, and then we'll talk about the report.
Yes, of course, John, and thank you so much for this invitation. So to tell you a little bit about MQ, MQ is a mental health research charity, which is based in the UK, but we fund research internationally. So over the last 10 years, we have distributed around 30 million in research in 37 countries. And we cover all the areas from prevention, detection, treatment, and all kinds of conditions. And besides funding research, we are also partners in research projects, and we use research to advise decisions and make sure that that research has an impact on real life. So this is kind of our day-to-day work is engaging with stakeholders and testing different ways to make research more useful.
And perhaps that leads into, tell us about this report. I put in the chat for those of you who just joined. It's free to download and read, but why did you even do this report? Or maybe tell us about the background.
Yes. So this project was actually, well, motivated but one part, and it is that this topic of mental health and the internet in young people is so prevalent in the press, in conversations. We see books and articles from all over, but the quality of the content is very varied. So there's a lot of very good quality content and very bad quality content. So we thought with this report, but I really wanted just to have a comprehensive view of what do we know for sure from good evidence, what are some indications and where are the gaps. And also besides consolidating this knowledge to be able to offer it in a way that it can be useful for different stakeholders. So we wanted to identify research gaps, but also provide actionable recommendations for individuals, families, policy, industry, and also highlight best practices and examples across the report to highlight potential ways to solve these issues.
Yeah, no, it's such a hot topic. There's, again, some evidence in people that say technology and internet use is very bad. It's like smoking once, it's horrible. There's some people that say it's wonderful, the more the better. There's some evidence that says it depends, it's both ways, but it's very confusing if you will ironically go on the internet to learn about what the internet is doing to youth mental health. There's a lot of opinions and evidence and viewpoints, and I think they all have a place, but it's nice to have a report trying to get a synthesis of what we're seeing and what does the higher quality evidence show us. So maybe a question for both of you is, how did you, what information went into the report? How did you create this and whose views were represented?
Mm-hmm. Yes. So one of them, so this report was built, we worked on this with the University of Melbourne Origin. So they did a comprehensive review of the longitudinal evidence. But then separately, we looked at indications from cross-sectional evidence, and we also, well, we were very lucky to have the contributions, well, from John here to the social media section and from the Oxford Internet Institute that contributed to our sessions, to our sections on artificial intelligence and gaming. But besides the evidence, we also conducted consultations with international stakeholders. So that included researchers, families, young people themselves, and so forth. And this is where we had the privilege also to have the contribution of Tawanada representing the views of the youth and of low and middle income countries. So those were kind of the content itself of the report. But the project itself, besides the production of the report, it has also an engagement and influencing phase, whereas where we have been in conversations with actors such as Amnesty International, with advocacy actors, with public policy to make sure that the report and the findings are used. So with that, I think that is an overview, and maybe Tawanda can give us a little bit.
Maybe Tawanda, like, from doing this report and working with so many youth groups and students in Zimbabwe, do you think maybe before doing the report, what is the consensus? Is it that screen time and internet is good? Is it bad? Do different people have strong factions? What are you seeing on the ground?
Basically, I think in Zimbabwe and also globally, there is a poor data when it comes to internet use and mental health, especially among young people. So what I find out personally, like what we find out through this research, is the realization that there is much more that young people can benefit through use of social media, through use of internet, that can also help them to connect with themselves. Maybe giving reference to our WhatsApp platform that we created during COVID-19, and they provide hope to people who are losing hope through difficult times and through difficult moments, and that's the use of internet. So our take as here in Zimbabwe in terms of internet use, it provides social network, social support, connections, and also it provides a platform of healing, a platform of building resilience, among young people. But again, there's another side of internet use as well.
Yeah.
Sorry.
Sorry, Tuan, is this to Yo? Is this to the WhatsApp group, the Yopela group that you built?
Yes.
Yeah. And do you want to tell people even just a couple details about it? It's such an exciting project, just to give people maybe a quick flavor of how you built it and who it serves.
Okay. It all started as not that serious initiative, as something that is for funny. So I started it 2019 during COVID-19. And so that's when I also opened my organization, Young People Mental Health Trust. So from there, I was like, okay, now there's COVID-19. How best can we approach people and how best can we reach out to people? Because we're facing restrictions of lockdown. So I then started one group, and then within 30 minutes, it was full. And then we started another group, and within an hour, it was full. And we started 13 WhatsApp groups with a capacity of around 6,000. That was 2019 to 2020. So we've been building those groups and people just joining, and then we serve whereby we can invite experts in terms of mental health, drug and substance use, whereby they will come in and share their experience and their expertise with the young people in Zimbabwe. And that's where also I met Mariana. She presented in those groups back in 2020. Do you believe it? Long back. So it serves as a community whereby young people join and then they learn and then they understand mental health. So what we provide is we provide psychoeducation. That's number one. We also psychoeducation whereby we teach people about mental health, about psychology, about drug and substance use, all those. And then again, it's also a social, it offers a social support whereby we support those with you know, who are experiencing difficult times. And again, it also offers counseling services because we also have counselors who will be online checking if someone is maybe is suicidal or if someone is showing signs of depression or signs of anxiety, something like that. So they will be detecting, they'll be checking the messages and reading and then detect and then predict, and then they will follow up to the user and say, do you want to talk? If you want, we are here to help you. So we're offering those three, three different things within your WhatsApp platform. Yes.
Yeah, that's very impressive. And the fact that you grew it organically, right? It started from a real world need, and it's nice to hear your story of it, to see like you're serving 60,000 people. I read like that's a lot of people, and I'll say, as a psychiatrist, I don't think I reach 60,000 people. I hope I can reach lots of people, but so it's nice to kind of see that tangible example of benefits. That said, the report is very balanced. And I think maybe Mariana, you can speak to some of the concerns that people, or you and the team figured out in the world of internet and social media.
Yes, of course. And well, just because we are starting to talk about the benefits just on this part, based on Tawanda's story. So something surprising is that most of the evidence is focused on the harms and on the risks, but there is very little evidence on the benefits and how they can be leveraged. So one of the advantages of looking at the internet, like the whole online world comprehensively, is that we could identify shared mechanisms of benefit and risk in different activities. So for instance, in benefit, as we have seen, well, the part of social connections, of having access to essential services and information, is so important. And also, well, through the internet, young people explore skills, curiosities, even their identities, which is also so important, especially in adolescence and for people who are LGBTQ or that maybe don't find their tribes in the offline world, then the online world also becomes an expansion of that. And also as Tawanda was saying, well, it's a way of empowerment. We, in our consultations, for instance, we consulted the neurodiverse people, and it was so important for them, social media, to connect with autistic influencers and to claim an identity and campaign and so forth. And those benefits are usually kind of absent, like those empowering parts are absent from the analysis. And also just another thing that I wanted to point out, which is another contribution of the report, is also to have some ideas of how does a healthy internet use looks like. So one of the things that we found is that one big part or one big concern and also a mechanism of potential harm of the internet is that it can displace or replace healthy habits or things that we know that are good for mental health. So for instance, sleep, homework, or family connections, and so and these kind of things. So one key, for instance, advice that we gave to parents and to families is also to consider what the young person can be doing instead of the internet activity. So internet activities are not good or bad per se, but it just how do they balance with other activities. So a young person that has access to extracurricular activity, that has lots of friends, that has a very fulfilling life offline, then the online world can become an expansion of that already fulfilling life. For young people, for instance, who are in more underserved or marginalized communities, that they have less access to entertainment options or education, then the internet becomes is riskier, because then that becomes essentially free time is the internet. So that leads them to unbalanced use or addiction like behaviors. And well, the vulnerabilities also can be different from different groups of people.
I think that summarizes it really well, because in the report you say, look, there could be cyberbullying, there could be displacement, there could be social comparison. But on the other hand, there's a lot of benefits, as Tawandi really illustrated for us. And I think one thing the report makes clear is screen time itself is not a useful metric, right? If I'm on Tawandi's group and I'm getting great support, that's wonderful screen time. If I'm being bullied on a different group, that's horrible screen time. So I think we don't actually have a tremendous metric in using screen time or online time. It's almost like a shadow, but it's a shadow of what? We don't fully know. And I think the report does a very nice job helping us kind of untangle what could be behind the shadow. And it's different for different youth, and it's different for different situations. And I do think we, as you said, a lot of the research is on the negative effects, but there can be positive as well. But maybe one question for each of you is, in doing the report and talking to people across the world, different groups, what was one thing that maybe surprised each of you the most? And you guys are both experts in it, so I imagine not too many things surprise you, but something you said, oh, that's not what I expected to find in doing this work.
Well, I don't know, Tawanda, do you want to go first?
Okay, I think one thing that surprised me is most people, when you talk about, I think I mentioned it earlier on, like most people when you talk about internet use and young people's mental health, they mostly focus on the negative side of internet use. And then they just thought that internet use is so bad to young people. So it was quite interesting for me, because I have lived experience with using internet for the good of our young people here in Zimbabwe. So it's quite, you know, it was quite interesting to notice that. And also, if you look at the literature that is available on internet again, some of this literature, they look on the negative sides as well of internet use to young people. So it's that just surprised me. And also when I was talking about these are the guys from, I think it's India. You know, when we were doing the consultation and all that, we realized that there is much more strictly the parent control. In the way they were emphasizing on the parental control on the internet to children. Probably again through research, probably we don't, maybe there's no more data on that, on the effectiveness of parent control and the use of internet. But again, is it possible to control young generation from internet, or we can maybe try by all means promote the use of internet to them? Again, that was surprising to me, because internet nowadays is also a source of income to a lot of young people as well. I think those two, I was quite surprised from realizing and also working with other people, and also what they think and their perceptions when it regards to internet use and youth mental health.
I think it reflects the diversity, and kind of this is a report done of teams across the world. So you weren't getting just, say, the Zimbabwe perspective, the UK perspective, the US perspective. You do see that, as you said, access to phones may be different in different areas. So what works well in one region and culture may be a very bad idea if parents are controlling the phone in certain areas. And maybe, Mariana, I think that's a hard one to beat as a wonderful answer to what they gave us. But anything you want to add to a surprising or unique finding from this report?
Yeah, well, one of the things that really surprised me, and it's not that much of a finding, but just like in terms of obstacles to advance like in this area. And one is really first the fragmentation of research. It makes it difficult to advance in this area, particularly because technology goes so fast. And so I think that something that really surprised me is where the recommendations and the public debate is, and where technology is. Technology is so way advanced. We are debating screen time, which, considering that in a few years, the internet is going to be omnipresent, is going to be in our fridge, in our watches, so many devices, that is just really controlling screen time. It seems kind of not the right question. But then one area where I would really like to emphasize, and this is not, well, because we have highlighted the benefits of the internet, but there are a lot of risks and things that can be better. And that I would say that the second thing that surprised me is how the infrastructure of the internet, so the digital architecture, the commercial practices, the economic models of the internet, the monetization of attention, surveillance capitalism, the capturing of data, and how all of these mechanisms are triggering mental health mechanisms for profit without much control. So I think that oversight is something that surprised me, and that I would really like to emphasize, because that also, that oversees social media, gaming, and every other activity.
It's a valid point of the complexity too. Maybe one quick question for each of you that I want to open up to a little bit of questions from the audience. To make progress in this space, I think we acknowledge there's risks, there's benefits. We may not have fully explored the benefits. We may have learned more about the risks. What do you each see could be impactful? What could researchers or government or funders do that you think would kind of just be impactful? And it's a broad question, but I want to see just like where you wish the space would go, or what you're seeing could change.
Well, I think from my side, one would be good measures. If we are able to understand what are the boundaries between good and bad, so what is marketing, what is addiction, and when is something social connection, or is it social comparison, and where are the boundaries between these things, I think that would be really important. Second, is in terms of regulations and policies, there's one area that is also overlooked is human rights instruments. Right now, regulations around AI, internet, social media are still in progress. The scope is undefined, but human rights instruments, they are legally binding for states, and also states that subscribe this instrument have the responsibility to enforce these with companies. So that is a key area that can be leveraged and that new regulations can build on.
That makes sense. Any thoughts to Tawanda to on top of that?
Yeah, I agree with you, Mariana, on the issue of for measures, because we have a lot of generalized study on the about internet use and the impact it has to mental health. Probably now I think we have to narrow it down so that we can have specific research on a specific area, so that we can also have specific measures for a specific problem when it comes to internet use and mental health, not just to broaden it. Because when you just broaden it, like, you realize that it doesn't give much data, and at the same time, it will be very, very difficult to measure. So at the end, you do compromise the validity of the research. So I think that's what we need to work on going forward.
Yeah. I think those are two wonderful answers. I want to open it up to questions for a couple of minutes. Before I switch to questions, I'd be remiss if I didn't acknowledge that this report was also made possible by Lee Mulligan, who was the CEO of MQ and tragically passed away in last year. But he had a tremendous passion and excitement for the space. And I think his vision lives on really in the work that you guys are telling us about in doing it. So it's nice to see kind of an MQ leader still having a wonderful influence in the field and kind of spreading that positive energy with it. But I'll jump to our first question. And this is interesting. It says the Australian government is moving to pass a bill that bans teenagers under age 16 from accessing social media. This could be happening this month. Do either of the panelists, do you have an opinion on it? Is this going to be, should we be banning it? Should we not be banning it? Is there something in between? Seems like it's happening now. So help us help Australia.
Tawanda, do you want to go first?
Yeah, no, I'll go second.
Well, I would say, and this is because these are measures that are taking, like, in different areas of the world. And from my perspective, it makes sense from a pressure, like a market pressure perspective, to force also technology companies and big tech to take more radical protective measures. So I think from that angle can be useful. And also as a maybe an emergency or temporary solution. I don't think that banning it makes sense in the long term. And also, well, people who are close to teenagers and kids, they know that they will find a way if they want to be connected. But as a temporary measure, like emergency measure, and to pressure, to exert like market pressure, it can be effective, at least in the short term, but I would not prioritize it like as a solution.
Maybe I'll add, I think a lot of the the report highlights, we don't have the best data. And Tawanda, you said, right, we don't have the best measures. We may need to force the companies to share the data with us, right? In essence, it's very hard as clinical or research teams to get access to the data to know what's really happening. And that data exists. It's a reflection of digital traces. So I do think perhaps legislation that opens transparency could also help as one, say, building off, again, what both of you said in it. A related, quite a different question says, as both of you said, the research moves slowly, the internet, technology, screen time moves quickly. It's going to be hard to ever catch up. Do you think, how can we better involve young people in research and informing our practices? Because they're the ones we're talking about, they're the ones seeing it, they're ahead of it. How do we make sure their voice is represented? Because they may have a better idea than all of us together. And I think you did a nice job in this report of getting the young people's viewpoint, but how do we keep that energy and momentum going?
I want to go and go after it.
Okay. I think first of all, when it comes to involvement of young people, we have to educate them first, like raise awareness on especially on why are we doing these things, because and then if we try by all means to educate them, then we also want to empower them, and then if we give them that empowerment, they will take it as their own. Young people, they don't want to be left out. We don't want to be left out. We don't want to feel like this thing doesn't belong to us. So when we are doing research as well, let's try by all means to involve young people so that they feel like they're in control of the work. And so that we also try to talk about positive internet. Like myself, I always talk about the positive benefits of internet. You know, so let's try by all means to promote that as well on our internet. So I last week in Zimbabwe, I heard that the president is actually planning to give a serious law when it comes to internet. What are you posting on the internet? And is it promoting something immoral, or is it promoting something good, so that another person would learn, or is it devaluing our values as a country? So here in Zimbabwe, I think that's a good step to make sure that the young people are posting something positive. They are not posting something about cyberbullying or something about all those things that might end up affecting someone's mental health. So I think that's the measure now, to say, okay, young people, we have the platform, this is the internet, you use it. But when you are using it, make sure that you are posting something positive. I think that's how then we can involve young people to be part of the team. And as well, whenever we are doing research, let's also try to make sure that our research is also focusing on the youth, focusing on the young people, and try by all means to get into those young people who are influential. We have young people who are into tech. We have young people who are into app designs. We have young people who are into all those things, you know. But we also have to include them in the process of research, in the process of our researches, so that others will follow, say, oh, this is the tech guru, and he is involved in a research, or she's involved in this research. So why not, or why should we also not follow suit? So I think that's always important. When you're dealing with young people, know the most influential person across the young people, and then involve that person into the research, and then others will follow suit as well.
I think that's well said, and MQ has certainly led the way in making sure that everyone's voice is involved, especially young people. I think there's time for one very brief question, then we have to conclude. This is from Soumya Chowdhury, who's a brilliant researcher in India and clinician, saying, is there more MQ work in low-middle-income countries such as India or more resources that people can access if they've been excited about this report? And then after that, we'll have to conclude.
Yes, absolutely. So we do have a network, a lived experience network. So I'm happy also to share the link. And yes, we are continually conducting well research projects in this and other topics, and yeah, we always look forward to more representation in low and middle income countries. And just sorry, before you conclude, just can I just one message that is just essentially in terms of how to drive things forward in this space is also in research, we are very good at producing knowledge and releasing research. But organizations such as MQ and others and this work that we do of actually bringing the research to people, making them in a format that they understand, using different channels, social media, digital and non-digital channels, for this advocacy work that we want to do with big tech to share the data with independent research. That's why we are working internationally, working with PwC, working with Amnesty International and so forth. So these collaborations are so useful. So please feel free to reach out for anything. We are always just like looking to add efforts.
Yeah, no, it's a wonderful report. And thank you both, Tawanda and Mariana, for the discussion. I said we're sadly out of time, but I put the report in the link and people can find it. So thank you, everyone.